Just wanted to give a big thank you to everyone listening to this podcast episode. Our sponsor for this episode is Anchor. Anchor is the all-in-one place to record your podcast. And don't worry, it's completely free. It allows you to record straight from your phone or computer. You can also distribute your podcast through Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and so many more. So download the free Anchor app today or go to anchor.fm. Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Action Filmmaking Podcast, the podcast dedicated to breaking down action films of all types. My name is Darren Tun, and with me is my amazing co-host, Mike Messina. Today, we have a very special guest, Tom Struthers. He has an extensive filmography, including stunt coordination for the Dark Knight trilogy, Inception, Dunkirk, as well as Bollywood films like Race 3, Tigers in the High. Tom, how are you?
Good afternoon in New York. Yeah, very well. Thanks, guys. How are you?
Yeah, doing all right. How has everything been going on with you, especially given quarantine and the current state of things?
It is what it is, you know. And I quarantined in Europe. I was in Budapest on a project which shut down, obviously, beginning of March. And so I just stayed put and quarantined there and kept locked up for 10 weeks. And it was quiet and calm, and there was not a lot of cases in Hungary where I was. And it was safe, so that was good. Now I'm home in Los Angeles again now and just seeing what's going to happen with our business due to the pandemic and when it's going to open up and, you know, restrictions will be and how we can overcome these obstacles and get done what we need to do.
Yeah, definitely. I'm glad everyone's safe over by you, though.
Yeah, it's good. I mean, I obviously live in Los Angeles and I'm away a lot. And it was good to see that, you know, like when I was in Budapest on a project, and it was good to see that people just were respectful of everyone and they listened to the government's advice, and they had a very, very low incident rate. It was really good.
Good to hear. Good to hear. So not a lot of horseback riding lately, I take it.
No, not a lot. that'll be next week up in the north of the US. I've got horses up there, and I'll be up there next week just relaxing in the sunshine until we figure out the movie business, you know?
That's the way to do it, I think. That's the way to do it.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, so we know that you come from a big background of horseback riding, things like that, especially growing up on a cattle ranch. Your first job in the industry was through training horses for an Indiana Jones TV show. So yeah. I was wondering, at what point in your career did you sort of set film and stunts as your future and your passion and switch over from horse training and things like that?
I just think that probably in the late 90s, it was one of those things, because I'd got into the business through a stunt coordinator and second unit director called Simon Crane, who I worked with, you know, extensively for about 10 years. And I had a farm in Africa, and it was like there was an issue with the farming community and the government at the time there. And then we decided to move to the United Kingdom, and I kept working for Simon all these years and for about 10 years. And then a lot of projects with him. And then so I've been European and US based since 97.
Gotcha. And what was that relationship with Simon like? Did you guys sort of hit it off right away, or did you have to build up that relationship?
I think you always build relationships, but we hit it off really well. It was in Kenya where I first met, and we had a farm in Tanzania, and I was up in Kenya, and they needed horses, and I had a bunch of horses at the time there. And they just one day, him and the horse master man called Jordi Casares from Madrid, Spain, said, you know, can we do this and can you do that? And I was a young kid, and they needed some young Caucasian riders, so I was like, okay, fine, mate. And then next thing they said, would you like to come work for us again? And in those days, around like in Africa and places like that, you know, foreign currency was very difficult to get a hold of because of the laws of the land where you were, basically. And I said, look, if you're paying dollars, and I'll go anywhere you need me to go. That was it, really. And, you know, here I am all those, you know, bloody near 30 years later. It's provided me, that was my apprenticeship, and it provided me a great base to work from.
No, definitely. That's awesome, like, that you started out that way. We were doing a little bit of digging, actually, and we know that you mentioned that Pather Panchali, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it correctly, but you really love this film, Pather Panchali, and we were checking it out, and we noticed that there wasn't really many, like, explosions or big action set pieces in this film, but it was kind of like a slower paced, like, emotional story. So we were kind of thinking, did you always have, like, an appreciation for this kind of genre?
Yeah, I think so. I was very lucky and fortunate. I grew up in a very, what we call cattle stations in Australia. Like, people probably recognize here in the United States, around the world, as a ranch. Well, I grew up in a large cattle, sheep and cattle station in Australia, and I was fortunate enough to go to a good boarding school in Sydney, and they had a good appreciation of the arts, which was my introduction, you know, in high school, you know, first starting high school after primary school in the outback. It was an eye opener. It was just different for me, coming from a cattle background and riding horses and not really answering to anyone or appreciating the arts. And it gave me it opened a window and a door, so to speak. And I absolutely loved it. I loved the stage plays we did and the technical side and the lighting and all those kind of things that went into it, and the drama.
100%. Yeah.
And I think that's what, when this opportunity come up with Simon Crane many years later, because I mean, I was back in the outback of Australia and as a young guy and I rodeoed and raised cattle and stuff like that. And then I went back to Africa when I was in my early 20s, and that's when I met him. And I think it just automatically led straight into it, because I never went searching for it. I never thought about being a stuntman or a stunt coordinator or a second unit director. And I think that it's not about falling into it. I think the opportunity arose, and I've always tried to make good of any opportunities that come our way and to do the best job possible. And I think Simon recognized that when I was very young, and I just took it, both hands. It's like, you know what? Life can throw, curveballs at you sometimes, and you either react to it or you don't. I think I just reacted to those
right.
I just went with them. And it's provided me a very good working career now, and obviously no ranching anymore, but it's what I do. It's what I love to do. It's been fantastic for me.
That's awesome. Yeah. I'm kind of wondering though, with this like slower type of emotional storytelling, how does like an appreciation for these kinds of films actually help you in the action genre, where like there's like a lot of stunts and it's like it's very heavy on that?
The thing is, anything we do, you know, whatever department you work on in film, TVs, commercials, stage productions, I think you've got to have an appreciation that what everyone's trying to do and come together. And I think I do like drama period films. I love to see how, you know, people adapt and, you know, they're able to portray a character and then you have someone who obviously is, good cameraman, DOP, or, good director. And I mean, it's amazing. Like a lot of what I consider the great directors come from a drama based background. I mean, I was just very, very fortunate to have just worked with Denis Villeneuve, on Dune, the new Dune that's coming out at the end of this year. And what an incredible director, you know.
Blade Runner,
And all the way back to the things, Sicario and stuff like that. And he hasn't had a big influence on my career, but being able to work for someone like that who appreciates the drama is always a learning curve. I mean, I think everyone can see that one of my main mentors and supporters in our business, besides Simon Crane, was Chris Nolan. You know, and I worked for a couple of years with Chris, and then as a supervisor, and then he brought me on as his stunt coordinator, overall in charge of all action. And he's very good under that umbrella.
Right.
Anything that has to do moves or on set, he relies very heavily on me. And you know, we talk about the drama, we talk about actors and actresses, and so that's a long answer. The short answer is, I think I just appreciate whatever everyone does.
100%. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think one thing that Darren and I, especially as film nerds, really appreciate is seeing all of the stunts done practically or with actual actors and things like that.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You just broke up a little bit there, Mike. Say again, Mike.
Yeah, so Darren and I, being big film nerds, we really appreciate practical effects and seeing actual stunts done in real life. We also know CGI is becoming really big in Hollywood, although there is definitely a resurgence, I think, in doing actual stunts and practical effects. Where do you personally see Hollywood going in terms of stunts? And then where do you see Bollywood going as well?
Well, it's really hard, the predictions of where things are going, because I mean, new mediums and new way of doing things is what we're all about as a human race, I suppose, at some certain degree, or innovative, and whether it be in making cars or making movies or whatever, we're always trying to think about how to do something better or different. And a lot of things have been done, obviously. But to answer your question, I think there's room for everything. I think there's always going to be directors who really like your Chris Nolan, who really would like to shoot in camera. And then any sort of tidying up, so to speak, any enhancement of background, any enhancement of the practical effects, that's what they do. Look at Inception, for example. Everything that we did in the corridor fight, zero-G gravity, that was all practical in camera. And then some of the backgrounds, like there's one scene where the city sort of folds over on itself and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah, classic.
You know, everything, you know, up to about 35 feet was all practical. And then after that, obviously the rolling over is digital and stuff like that.
Green screen, right.
It's a blending. Where it's going in the future, I think there's always going to be a place for good performers, good artists. I think the stunt community complement our main cast members and always have done. And I think they in return also do. They provide a good drama-based portrayal or whatever the character is. And then when it becomes to a certain point where, as we know, your stunt performer comes into the his or her mix because of the level of danger is raised, and that's what they train for, that's what they do to protect our cast members and protect the production and the insurance companies. So I think there's always going to be a room for stunt performers, especially good stunt performers who are good at their craft. You know, it's like anything around the world. You know, everyone has different levels of proficiency. There's some that are right up there, and there's some that are mid-level, and there's some that, you know, really will never be fantastic at it. It's like any kind of medium we're in, whether you're a sportsman or where, you know, you ride a push bike on the weekend, or, and you know, you're not going to be an Olympic cyclist. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. 100%.
Yeah.
So we definitely want to get into Bollywood now, actually, a Bollywood section, because I know you played a big part in Tigers in Dubai and Race 3. We're kind of curious how you first got into the Bollywood scene and transitioning into there from Hollywood.
Well, I did a thing some years ago in Bollywood. Actually, it was actually, to be honest with you, that's a bit embarrassing. The names just went out of my head. I'm a bit jet lagged at the moment because I've been traveling for 2 days.
No worries.
But anyway, I did this project some years ago in Bollywood, and it had Rishi Rapoor, who's just recently died, a famous Indian actor, and Arjun Rampal. He's another very famous Indian actor married to Miss India, so I did that. And then a couple of years after that, I got a call from a director and saying about, with Salman Khan, would I like to do a project? And I was like, you know what, why not? I mean, I'm up for any kind of project that's challenging. It doesn't matter whether it's a $100,000 commercial or less even, but, or, you know, a small film or a large film, you know, they all take the same effort.
Of course.
They've all got different challenges. You know, some have got challenges about environment and performance and performers, and they don't have the money issues, and the other have the money issues and they have good performance. So, you know, it's a day-to-day management situation.
It's a balance.
It is very much so. I had a really great time on Tiger. I was in UAE and I was in India and Austria. They filmed at quite a lot of locations, which was quite unusual for Indian films, but it was the box office hit of the year when we did it. I won a Filmfare Award on the 63rd annual Filmfare Awards. It's like the Indian Oscars have been going for 63 years. I've actually won two. D-Day was the name of the other project, the first project I did there, which I also won a Filmfare Award for action directing. Like here in the United States, we have the Oscars. There is no recognition for second unit directors, action directors, or stunt coordinators. Mm-hmm. So the Indian Bollywood, they do recognize it. They do award it. So I have two statues, which is very appreciated. And then I did Tiger, and then I did Race. And they're both Salman Khan pictures. I mean, the genre is different. The way you approach it is different. What they want to see on screen is very, very different. But as a technician, so to speak, as a visually and technically, and also, you know, creatively as a second unit, you know, whether it's Hollywood or, you know, European cinema or Bollywood, for example, you know, you're there to do what the director's vision is, you know, and if the director wants things to be the action, you know, it's very unbelievable. Action is big and open and
right.
It's quite crazy in Bollywood films, and it's very, very unbelievable. But that's the market they're targeting. And, you know, the main unit director is, whichever way you look at it, it's his vision that the studios or the investors are paying for. And so that's what you do. You know, you step up to it and just get, you know, you give them the product that they're looking for, you know, and that's what rehearsals are for, and preparation and pre-prep and you, all the discussions and the storyboards and everything. And what I might like to do in regards to certain action and keeping it grounded, and like your Dunkirk and your Inception and stuff like that, that's not what they wanted, you know, which is fair enough. So it's an experience in itself, just to adapt to a different way of doing things and a different approach to it. And at the end of the day, you're making films or TV, whatever it might be. It's an illusion. You know, it's entertainment. So if that's a form of entertainment, you do the best job you can for that genre that you're doing it for, you know?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. We were kind of watching through some of these films too. And it was kind of interesting. The run times were so long compared to Hollywood films.
Mm-hmm. Well, see, they shoot tremendously long shoots for those big Bollywood pictures, and their editing is totally different approach to ours. You know, we normally have very much a first, second, and third act of the project, you know, the film, and we build it up and you know, condense it and tell a story and try and get that story across well. But if you watch Indian production, sometimes it's very hard to follow the story because they honestly don't care. You know, they shoot for 12 months. And then they'll put together a 3 or 4 hour movie. And in India, cinema is king. People love it, especially when you have your heroes like the Salman Khans, who, you know, there's a couple of other big action figures. They've loved him for years. And I mean, and it's incredible that it's more like a worship kind of devotion to their stars. So people will pay any amount of money to go to the cinema to sit down for 3 hours and see Salman Khan. They don't mind if Salman Khan is whatever it might be. They don't care about the story, which is interesting, you know. Then on the other side of it, you have the more serious things, like the Project D-Day I did with Rishi Yarpour, just recently died, bless him. And Efron Khan, he was also in it, another gentleman that's just passed. He was in the project too. Mm. It was more serious, and it was unusual for Bollywood cinema, but director Nicole Advani, you know, he wanted to do something a little bit more serious. And it didn't make huge amounts of money like some of our indie films in the West here, but it was so very well received. It won a lot of awards and you know, it was just great. But one of the things is I explained to the producers, and Salman and I were talking about when I was in India about 4 or 5 years ago, is you might notice it's like everywhere else in the world, everyone has a smartphone. So they can watch YouTube, they can watch Netflix and
wherever Amazon. They want.
Yeah, and it's affordable. I mean, I've been in some of the worst, you know, poorest areas of Mumbai, and you see kids with a smartphone, you know, and
It's crazy. I've seen that.
Yeah, and they're watching Netflix. So they understand, you know, the medium of media over there has changed. You still have your diehard people who just want to see big over the top, you know, physical drama with the heroes walking through the smoke with no shirt on, which is great, you know. So, but it's a great experience. And you know, I could never knock it. You know, I had great experiences there. You know, I think all over the world where I've been very fortunate to work in many, many countries around the world in my career. And hopefully there'll be many more. And every place I've been has something to offer that I didn't see before or didn't appreciate. Or it was just, it's new, you know. Last year I got to travel. I was in Jordan. I was in Lithuania. I was in Hungary, you know. And I'd never been in Jordan or Lithuania before. Unbelievable experiences in both countries for different projects, for different reasons, you know.
Definitely.
Yeah.
We also heard some story about a stranger inviting you in for tea and showing off his car collection. So just to give people an idea of how beloved you are in these places.
I don't know where you get these stories from. I was in, I think it's called Lewa. I was in up on the Saudi border in UAE. And I was at the gas station and this gentleman come up to me and it was like, would you like to come for a coffee? And I was like, he said, come on, you know, come to my property for a coffee. And I was like, okay, all right, why not? You know, I don't mind. So we went to this gentleman's house, and him and his wife and his kids, we sat, we had coffee and we talked and everything. He said, oh, let me show you, he's cut my cars. You know, we go in the garage. He's obviously, you know, he's quite wealthy in some respects. And the first thing you see on a marble floor is an original AC Cobra.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, he bought it here in the United States and shipped it back to UAE. What that would be worth, I would have no idea. And we're talking about horses. Now he's like, oh, come. So I went and seen, he had some beautiful Arab stallion horses in, you know, in the stables. And so just, it's amazing the people you meet around the world. I think that's one right. of the crews and, you know, locals. And I mean, this gentleman, obviously, I think he's possibly was part of the royal family in UAE, because I mean, he lived in a part of what was a palace where it is. And he was just absolutely accommodating and lovely. And you meet people like that all the time, you know, and mm-hmm. of all walks of life, you know, I mean, I've been in the desert in Morocco and Erfu many years ago, and been invited in to have tea. And, you know, it's a different end of the scale. One group of people couldn't be poorer. And I suppose the other gentleman, you know, last year where I met and I went for coffee with, he was on the other end of the scale. You know, he probably has more money than I'll ever see. But they were just, it didn't matter. You know, it was just really accommodating, nice people. When you meet people like that around the world, it makes you feel good, I suppose, at the end of the day, a little bit, that, you know, people are not all, you know, against each other. And yeah. which is a big thing. And I think in the day and age that we live in right now, I think that a lot of lessons can be learned about the hospitality and how nice people can be to each other. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter who you are. And I've always appreciated that.
Right. There's good out there.
Oh, I think there's a lot of good everywhere in the world. I don't think everyone, obviously not everyone is bad. And we should look at that rather than look at how bad people are. That's just, and I think in cinema, I think that, you know, we need to portray more, a little bit, maybe be a bit more sensitive and just more heartfelt drama stories, maybe. I mean, mm-hmm. obviously coming from the action side, a lot of the, you know, the people who I know and work in the stunt business and physical action, they just want to see all physical action. But the thing is, I've never been like that. I love to do physical action, but I like to do it really, really well with the performers and rehearse it and choose. But the thing is, it's not all about that. You know, I always feel that you've got to have a story. I always feel that you've got to have something that motivates you as an audience to really want to sit down and concentrate. You know, whatever you do, it won't always be the genre that everyone will like. You know, some people don't like war films. Some people don't like horror. Some yeah. people don't like drama. Some people don't like, you know, sci-fi. But at the end of the day, I think every single project, doesn't matter whether it's success or a failure or whatever it might be, they all have something in them that you think, oh, that looks really nice. Might be just, I don't know, a landscape, a camera move, or a piece of action, or a piece of drama, you know?
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I kind of want to get into the Tiger film now, because I know there was actually a horse chase in there. And I was kind of wondering, with your experience with horses and stuff like that, did that kind of help with the scene?
Yeah, it always does. We did that in Morocco. And that was done, my horse master and local stunt coordinator is a man called Cedric Proust. Cedric and I have known each other for damn near 25 years, maybe a bit longer. He's a French descent, but he's been in Morocco since he's 4 years old, and incredible stuntman himself and fantastic stunt coordinator. We actually are business partners. So in a lot of respects, you know, we've got horses and that in Morocco and vehicles and stuff, and he's got great horses. So we just, when they said, look, we want to film Morocco, we want to do a horse chase. I said, okay, great. We've got just the thing. So we've got, you know, big Frisian stallion and Salman rides. He's got horses of his own at his ranch in India. So we introduced him to the horses. He's like, he got on straight away. He's very adaptable, did a great job. And then away we went. We did a whole sequence in a little town called Essaouira in the Medina. Wow. On the coast of Morocco. And it's just incredible. It was just a lovely place to be. And yeah, it was very good.
A lot of horses. I love the horses. There was a brief scene with a horse as well, I believe, in the Dark Knight trilogy that I love to talk a little bit about, in the trilogy in general. I'd actually like to know, just from a big picture standpoint, actually, would you say your time in Hollywood has helped you when you're working in Bollywood and vice versa as well?
100%. I think that, like I was saying a little bit earlier in the conversation, wherever you go or whatever medium, you know,
right.
It helps your craft. You know, some of the things that, you know, they do in India, you go, look, you know, you would never do that in Hollywood. And, you know, we obviously there's a lot more restrictive in the working practice laws in Europe and America under, you know, OSHA and stuff like that, health mm-hmm. and safety. But there's certain little things you see them do. And with the camera and stuff like that. You think, oh, that's great, you know, and then you take it back to you when you come back to the West and you do that. And then you take your experience of big films and productions and looking after the financial side of it and that, and try and get the best people and the what you can and the best equipment so that you help them in their shooting day length, you help them on different projects. It's a mixture, you know. It's like every country, every people have something that you know, if you're looking, keeping your eyes open, that you could use to your own advantage and make your craft better. Definitely.
I love it. And with that, I'd love to now actually dive into the Dark Knight trilogy. I know you went from assistant coordinator to co-coordinator and then eventually to, I believe, the coordinator for the films. What was that like going through those different roles for the same franchise?
It was fantastic. I mean, in the first two, I was the supervisor, the floor supervisor for Paul Jennings, a very talented stunt coordinator, second unit director. And I'd known Paul since Braveheart, you know, and I was working for him and a lady called Cy Hollins. She was the assistant stroke co-coordinator, a very talented stunt woman and coordinator. And they basically, you know, because when a pitches of Chris's size, you got to have someone who's totally on the floor with him by his side to help advise, right, take direction and orders and organize everything so it's exactly where it needs to be for him, so he's not waiting. Because, you know, he's such a fantastic director. There's no waiting. There's no lost time. It's all ready and you're ready to go. And it makes a safer environment and it makes for better action. But anyway, so I did the first two as a supervisor on Chris's unit. And then the last one, I was overall in charge as stunt coordinator of all of it. And it was a great trilogy to work on. I mean, you know, there's been Batmans before and there's been a couple after and that, but I think that the Chris Nolan Batmans with Christian Bale, they very much stand alone. I think their style, I think genre, the way that Chris deals it, you know, we kept very much everything in camera, even the opening sequence in the last one out of the back of the C-130. That's never been done before in manner, with four people being dragged behind a cargo airplane in the middle of the sky. You know, I think that it was just a great experience and a good time to in my life to be working, doing those things. And the people that we had around us, you know, they're the best at what they do. And everyone did a fantastic job, you know. And the first two were really great because then obviously I knew Chris very well. And I think Paul was unavailable for the third one. So, you know, I got offered the opportunity and it just worked very well.
Definitely. And now, does Christopher Nolan actually give you like a lot of freedom in terms of like the stunt coordination, or is he like involved in like the technical process behind it?
He gives me so much freedom, but he's also very, very involved because Chris knows everyone's job on a project. He didn't just decide he wanted to be a director. I mean, he worked all the departments as a kid, you know, and made student films, and he's obviously very talented, but he's also very astute. So he knows on the set everyone's job. He knows their job. He's a very intelligent man. And so, you know, like I remember on Inception, or it might have been the second Batman, it just said on one of the script pages, it just said car chase. So, okay. So we start putting together a car chase and we ended up doing this whole car chase, and I don't know how many pages of script it ended up being, but it took 6 weeks, you know.
Right.
But it, you know, it's research and development and the collective talking with Chris and the meetings and showing him rehearsal footage, and then he'll say, well, what about if we do this a little bit here? You go, okay, great, but we can't do that there, we have to change this location. All right, no problem, great, do that. And you know, I mean, Inception for me, when I did Inception, which was in the middle of the last two Batmans, which it was the most collaborative, unbelievable experience that I've had as a filmmaker.
I can imagine, yeah.
And, you know, with Wally Pfister, Nathan Crowley, myself and Chris, and his first AD, Nilo Otero, the five of us were joined at the hip for 5 months, basically. And every conversation, every little nuance about the film that we wanted to help bring to Chris's vision, And, you know, you bring 10 ideas, maybe one, maybe five, maybe none are any good. But if you just keep every day pushing and pushing and pushing and bringing ideas and bringing, you know, new methods of doing things and just trying to give Chris the vision he wants and listen. And with Chris Nolan, you know, he doesn't repeat himself. You know, if you're on a location scout and he goes, this is where we're going to have camera here, they'll come from here and then go there. You've got to be listening because that's what will happen. He doesn't change his mind. He's already got the film made in his mind when he sees location.
Yeah.
You know, I think that maybe the other person who's like that, the other two people a little bit like that is Steven Spielberg and Denis Villeneuve. They're both maybe a little bit like that. But Chris is definitely like that. You know, he knows before he rolls camera, he knows what he's looking to get from that environment, that scene, that, you know, location. You know, he's incredible like that.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I'd love to get into a little bit about the fight scenes, actually, especially in Dark Knight Rises. As a martial arts guy myself, I'm always very excited to see the hand-to-hand sequences that are present in these films. What kind of role did you play as an action guy in planning out those sequences?
Well, to be honest with you, I know what I want in my head and feel-wise and things like that. You know, like the fight side of things is not my forte, so to speak. You know, it's not something that I can go out. You know, I can put together a normal everyday fight. But it's not something that I specialize in. But as the overall stunt coordinator or second unit director, you've got to have your vision and references of what you might want. I mean, the first two Batmans, they used a method that these two guys come up called the KC method. So you have that. But in the third one, the last one that we did, you know, I had some quite talented fight people like in John Street and Buster Reeves. They helped me bring about the vision that I wanted and the level of violence or the level of proficiency that for Christian to be at. And, you know, because he's also a very talented and physical actor, he remembers all the moves. And it's fighting on film, and a lot of what we do on film or TV is very much, it's just a choreographed dance. It, you know, as long as you're in the right place at the right time, and you have an awareness of what's going on, that's what you need to have. You don't need to be an MMA champion or anything like that. A lot of the people who are the fighter rangers and that, they all have a great martial art background, fight background, a mixture. You know, and I like a mixture of all different styles of fighting.
Right.
You know, one of the last projects, we incorporated a lot of like Akali, the stick fighting methods. But, you know, like with the Batman, we use a little bit of KC, we use a bit of Krav Maga. There's some actually toe-to-toe boxing-type fighting. It depends on the visionist. And then when you have Tom Hardy, for example, playing Bane, Tom is a very physical fighter. He gets in the ring and he spars and grapples. So he himself is very physical and very moving, fluid moving. So he does great fight scenes. And look at Bronson. Look at the movie Bronson he did. I don't know if you've ever seen it. I mean, Tom Hardy. And he just lives for it. I mean, he lives for his characters, whatever it might be. So when you have the caliber of actors like that, how can you lose if you're proficient at your craft and you give them, you know, you're given the tools then to help them? It's every director's dream to have casts that will do that, like your Hardys, your Christian Bales and people like that, because they get it. They're there to do a job and they're really good at it and they help you and make you look good, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And so you mentioned you have some sort of a general vision for these action scenes. How specific exactly is that vision? Do you have different acts for a sequence set up in your head, or do you just have an overall feel?
Obviously, when you first start reading a script for a project, you know, you start imagining in your mind like how you feel would like to be. But then you get the feeling when you meet the director and the production designer about the sets, about locations, etc. And then the director's brief and how he feels about things and what they want to see. And that gives you your basis to work from. So then you can go back and put all your mind and all your energy into creating environments and sequences to fit what they're looking for.